What if I told you that the mushrooms you think of as magic carry centuries of hidden stories in their DNA? Beneath that familiar cap lies a world shaped by genetics, chemistry, and decades of experimentation, both underground and in laboratories. In this video, we're diving into the most talked about strains of psilocybe cubensis, from the classic Golden Teacher, MB+, to the famously potent Penis MB, to ask a simple but important question. Does strain really matter? We'll examine what gives these mushrooms their unique characteristics, appearance, potency, and cultivation quirks, and explore why certain strains have earned almost mythic reputations in both underground circles and emerging therapeutic settings. Of the nearly 200 psilocybin-containing species found worldwide, psilocybe cubensis is by far the most widely cultivated and studied mushroom. Its prominence in modern psychedelic research is primarily due to its ease of cultivation and deep cultural roots. This species has a long history of ceremonial use among indigenous cultures for thousands of years. Rewind the clock, and you'll find that the story of psilocybin goes much further back than you might expect. Research suggests that mushrooms have been producing psychedelic compounds for over 66 million years, well before the existence of modern humans. In other words, the magic in magic mushrooms predates us by tens of millions of years. Now, take a look at these two photos. At a first glance, they might look like completely different mushrooms, but they're actually the same species, psilocybe cubensis. Much like dog breeds, strains are selectively cultivated for specific traits. These traits include morphology, meaning its overall appearance, potency, chemical composition, and ease of cultivation. Similar to cannabis, different strains of psilocybe cubensis can produce noticeably different effects, and variation between strains has sparked growing interest among both cultivators and researchers, who are now exploring whether certain strains might be better suited for treating different ailments. Maybe one day, people will be able to choose a specific strain to help with anxiety or depression, in the same way that one might select a particular strain of cannabis for relaxation, focus, or pain relief, tailoring the psychedelic experience to meet individual therapeutic needs. While psilocybin and psilocin are the most well-known psychoactive compounds in magic mushrooms, cultivators are now paying closer attention to a broader range of tryptamines and chemical compounds like baeocystin, norbaeocystin, aeruginascin, and derivatives such as the metabolite hydroxypsilocybin. These lesser-known compounds may not be as potent on their own, but they're believed to play a role in what is known as the entourage effect, a theory suggesting that these molecules work together to shape the overall intensity, duration, and feel of a psychedelic experience, whether it's a microdose or a full-on trip. And while science continues to evolve, one factor that consistently grabs attention is potency. So before we dive into specific strains, let's take a closer look at why potency is so important. Potency isn't determined by strain alone, though it certainly helps. It can vary significantly, not just between mushrooms from the same batch, but even between the cap and stem of a single mushroom, each potentially containing different concentrations of psilocybin and related alkaloids. This makes consistent, precise dosing inherently difficult if you're working with the whole mushroom. What's more, cultivation conditions matter. Factors like substrate composition, nutrient availability, temperature, humidity, and light exposure can all influence not just yield, but the chemical profile of the mushroom. A more nutritious or well-balanced substrate may encourage the production of certain compounds or alter their levels in subtle but meaningful ways. Without standardized growing methods or reliable dosing guidelines, navigating potency can feel a bit like psychedelic roulette, where two mushrooms that look identical might produce very different effects. This push for higher potency goes beyond psilocybe cubensis. Cultivators and biotech innovators are exploring naturally stronger species like Paniolis cyanescens, aka blue meanies, and experimenting with gene editing techniques to possibly increase psilocybin content in mushrooms, though more research is needed to validate these methods. Another key motivation behind growing high-potency mushrooms is yield efficiency. The stronger the mushroom, the less material needed to achieve the desired effect, ultimately reducing costs and streamlining cultivation processes. As psychedelic-assisted therapy and related treatments become more prominent, the demand for high-quality, chemically consistent mushroom strains is only expected to grow. So how do cultivators develop new strains? The process of strain selection is quite nuanced and involves a deeper understanding of fungal biology. Maybe in another video we can discuss this in more detail, so comment below if you want more video content on this topic. But in this video, I'm going to break it down at its most basic level. A legal grower begins by selecting a mushroom they want to work with. For example, golden teacher. They collect spores from that mushroom and transfer them to a petri dish. Each spore germinates into a thread of monokaryotic mycelium, or monokaryon, which contains only half the genetic information needed to produce a fruiting body. By carefully pairing two compatible monokaryons, each from a different parent spore, the cultivator creates a dikaryotic mycelium, or dikaryon, which contains the full genetic blueprint needed to produce mushrooms. That dikaryon is then grown out, allowed to fruit, and evaluated. If the resulting mushrooms show promising traits, such as improved potency, yield, or resistance to contamination, the grower may continue refining through further selection and recombination. This process can be repeated across multiple generations until the desired characteristics are consistent. This simplified overview only scratches the surface, but it highlights just how technical and precise strain development can be. Many of the well-known strains we recognize today originated from either pre-existing strains or wild specimens that were carefully isolated, studied, and selectively bred. As I mentioned earlier, psilocybe cubensis is the primary species most cultivators work with, but even within cubensis, there are hundreds, maybe even thousands of different strains that exist. Every time you start a new grow from spores, you're playing a genetic lottery because there are millions of possibilities in just one spore syringe. Take Golden Teacher, for example, an easy-to-grow classic known for its golden cap and introspective effects. B Plus is another beginner-friendly strain prized for its adaptability and forgiving nature. Penis Envy, on the other hand, is famously known for its unusually high potency and thick phallic shape. Tidal Wave combines the potency of Penis Envy with the hardiness of B Plus, creating a powerful hybrid. And outside the cubensis category entirely, Natal Super Strength, a separate species from South Africa, is gaining traction for its strong visuals, smoother body experience, and reportedly friendlier effects. Of course, the effects of any strain can be highly subjective, as individual brain chemistry, mindset, and setting all play a role in shaping the experience. That said, these examples show just how varied the world of psilocybin mushrooms can be, even within a single species and genus. So does strain really matter? Well, it depends on what you're looking for. Strain influences appearance, potency, chemical profile, cultivation ease, and ultimately shapes the user's experience. However, this variation is most significant for those seeking a particular effect. For casual users, differences might be less noticeable, but for researchers, cultivators, and patients pursuing precise benefits, strain selection becomes crucial. As psilocybin moves towards wider therapeutic applications and standardized production, understanding these distinctions will only grow in importance. Just as a reminder, we do not advocate breaking the law by cultivating or using any of these mushrooms if they are illegal in your jurisdiction, but we do believe in open access to information and hope you found this video valuable. Thanks for watching, and I hope to see you again soon.